It's really nice to be back here. And you know, when they told me what the topic was, I said, "You're going to do something, a debate on the building code? You're never going to get anybody." But Vancouver, you never disappoint. More than 130 people out to talk about single stair exit and triple glazing and adaptable units. Yes, and so some of you who've attended other debates, especially the last one on the Downtown East Side, this one might seem a bit dry and impersonal, but I think I don't have to convince this crowd that building code regulations can also be very emotional and political. It's a very personal story for those who feel like they're denied housing because there aren't regulations for accessibility, or there's others, we've seen it, who feel threatened, but history is being destroyed because they can't have a round doorknob on their door, and others think their culture is being undermined because they can't use gas heating in their restaurant kitchens. And there's been a real pushback in some cities about that. San Francisco, I think, has actually rolled back some of those kinds of regulations. So I've ranted about my thoughts on this to various people, especially when it comes to homelessness and housing, because building standards have had a really big impact on a lot of social and economic issues. And when I first started studying housing and homelessness 25 years ago, this one book author, an academic, really made a point that really stuck with me, where he pointed out we were able to house a lot more poor people than we are today. Why? Almost no building standards. You could build any shitty tenement. You could build terrible row housing out of, you know, matchsticks if you wanted to. You know, so there was a lot of bad housing that was built, and it meant that people were not camping in tents on Hastings Street or living in, you know, other precarious situations. So gradually we introduced more stringent building codes, and as you'll hear from some people tonight, this has been going on for a long time. Someone made a reference to Hammurabi, so that's how far back we're going. The new regulations, as you know, were not brought in just because some crazed, overpowerful bureaucrat decided to make people's lives miserable. Many were brought in so that even poor people had places to live where they didn't have to worry about being burned to death or the roof collapsing if there was a big snowfall, things that I've actually covered in my career as a reporter. But sometimes there have been concerns, or you'll hear about it tonight, there have been concerns that a lot of new codes, new regulations were brought in without ever looking at how have things changed? Do we still have to do this? Is there too much of a redundancy here? Does this regulation still have to be in place when building materials and other standards have changed? I've been working on a story recently about something I know that will make you all shiver with delight, which is the single stair exit idea for smaller apartment buildings. It is interesting, and I know a lot of people are very enthusiastic about bringing that in to BC, and the government is studying it, but people who work in firefighting or building codes remind me that a lot of codes and regulations are what they call written in blood. In other words, something really tragic happened, and it resulted in a better fire code or more demands for, you know, climate-friendly building and so on. Those come about because people died. And I think we all know what's going to happen in Baltimore. And as a result of Baltimore, after the really terrible accident there, there's going to be a lot of examination about the building code for bridges, for one thing. So obviously there's a lot of tension when you talk about this issue. On the one hand, you do want to make things as safe as humanly possible, sometimes, as I said, through massive redundancy, or as you'll hear tonight, new precautions are added but none are ever taken away. On the other hand, if the requirements are too high, it can actually kill construction, make affordable housing unaffordable, and lead people to just, you know, try to find a way to circumvent the rules. So, you know, there is that tension between safety, wanting things to be perfect, and what sometimes gets into inexplicable rules. One of the ones that always puzzles me is you're not allowed to have, like, horizontal metal slats for a balcony railing here, but if you go down to Bellingham, they're allowed. You see them everywhere, and apparently people are not falling out of their buildings on a regular basis, or not enough to make Bellingham change their building code, or Washington, or whoever it is. So there, I think we all know there'll never be a complete consensus on what the balance is, but tonight we'll hear the arguments for and against, and where people think we are on the spectrum, too far, one way or the other. And they'll go into some of the current issues that I haven't done here. So, and you all are going to get to vote twice on where you think that balance should be, once before and once after the debate. And then, once you've figured it all out, you get to run for city council. That's the prize here tonight. Mike Klassen will tell you, who's sitting in the front row here from City Council, he'll tell you what a great job it is and how much people appreciate the job that councillors do. So it's a great prize. Okay, so our motion is that building code regulations should be reduced. And there's a lot of ways to word that, but that's essentially what it's going to come down to. There's going to be an Oxford-style debate where we have two people from each side arguing for and against. And it's fast-moving, and it, you know, requires a simple resolution that is argued for strongly by one side or another. And then, as I said, you will decide the winner by two votes. And the winner is the side that moves people the most. Sometimes there's not much of a movement. In the last one I was at, there was a huge, it was like a Japanese tidal wave or something like that. So that was an interesting one. So we'll see what happens here. A reminder that it's not the team with the most votes that wins the debate, but the team that changes the most minds. So here's how the evening will go. In just a moment, you'll vote pro or con on the motion. Then each of the four people will have a chance to give an opening statement of 7 minutes. Then there'll be an exchange period where the debaters get to pose questions and arguments to each other directly, and you can ask questions too. So get ready to leap out of your seat and grab the person with the microphone. I will be riding herd on all of that in case any fistfights break out or anything like that. Each debater will get a closing statement of 2 minutes. When the debate is completed, then you vote again. And as I said, the team that changes the most minds is the one who wins. So we're going to do the vote now. So you follow this QR code to the Vote One page. And there are paper ballots available for people, but you all look like you're so young. No hip replacements in this crowd, so I'm assuming not too many will need a paper ballot. Oh, here come the results. Oh my God. Okay, the meeting of the disgruntled architects is now called to order. So in the first vote, the pro side is 82% and the con side is 18%. So that adds up to 100, that's good. So now let's meet the teams and the people who will try to convince you to hold your position or change your mind. So, these people are very smart, very knowledgeable, much more than me. So that really makes them spectacular. And they're brave, You know, not everyone wants to come up and give their opinion in public, I've discovered. So please welcome tonight's city debaters. Tonight, oh, okay. So arguing the pro position, we have Inga Roker, who is an associate professor of architecture at UBC, where she specializes in studios focused on community partnerships and housing. She is the founder of Air Studio, and she's the co-founder of the interdisciplinary research collective Design for Inclusion, which explores resilience in urban communities through architectural inquiry. And she's also out in the world doing real projects that make her tear her hair out, I understand. And her teammate is Cash Burrell, an engineer with over 25 years of experience in building code consulting, fire protection engineering, in addition to his structural background, and he's the managing principal of GHL Consultants Limited and a member of Engineers and Geoscientists of BC, the Society of Fire Protection Engineers, and the National Fire Protection Association. So the other side's not going to be able to win on fire code rules. So that's your team for the pros, for the pro side. So Inga and Cash, can you come down? I don't know. Does the song have something to do with? Oh, the change will do you good. Okay, good. Okay. Now, arguing against the resolution, Rick Chung is the assistant fire chief for Vancouver Rescue Services. He's an engineer who's been actively involved in the development of building and fire codes for many years. He teaches a BC Building Code course at BCIT and sits on the standing committees of fire protection and on use and egress, single stair people, for the National Building and Fire Codes of Canada. And his teammate is Aaron Meyer, who is a building code consultant at LMDG Building Code Consultants Limited, where he works with design teams to meet the requirements of the building code from the first napkin sketch, I didn't know you still did that, but okay, through to construction. He also works with various local governments, provincial ministries, and First Nations in reviewing and enforcing the requirements of the code. So let's welcome the con side down to the stage. And for those who can't see it, and I didn't spot it myself, but that bow tie is made of wood. But fire resistant, I hope.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so now each debater gets 7 minutes to make an opening statement. There'll be visuals for those of you who are visual learners. We're going to begin with Cash taking the first spot. Okay, you're on.
Pictures speaks a thousand words.
It's jumping. Sorry, what happened? There we go.
I'm going to blast through my contents. Items that I'm covering is, what's the focus of the presentation? Why do we need building codes? A brief history of building codes, and what's the Canadian code models under? And then some of the changes that have happened over the years with respect to fire and life safety, some examples, and then discuss some of the challenges. Just want to make it very clear that I'm not a structural engineer, I'm a fire protection engineer, and my specialty is Part 3 of the BC Building Code and Vancouver Bylaw. but most of my comments are with respect to the BC Building Code. Why do we need codes? Codes are needed to provide a consistent level of safety that is acceptable to the public. And there's an expectation from the public that there has to be, when they enter a building, it is safe and they don't have to do a safety check. So codes are needed. I'm not disputing they should be thrown out. They are needed for sure. Now, in terms of the history, we can go through this graph, but generally speaking, and I'm glad Francis mentioned some disasters that happened over the years, but safety codes with respect to fire were evolved when there were large fires in the world. From many, many centuries ago, they started whenever there was a large fire, the codes evolved. Now, the first National Building Code of Canada was released in 1941, and from 1941 to 2005, these codes remained essentially prescriptive. And the latest available edition of the National Code is the 2020 National Codes. The National Code of Canada gets updated every 5 years. So that's kind of an evolution of the Canadian codes. Now, what do these codes entail? Is they're basically a set of rules. Some of them are scientific, some of them are not scientific. They're used as a guide. There's a date mistake in there. From 1941 to 2005, they remained predominantly prescriptive. Over the years, they became more and more restrictive. Every time a new requirement was added, the older ones were not taken out. And what happens is the national code is released and each province takes the national code, puts it in their own province, and they make the unique to province changes to that. So that's the next slide. Now, there are three different models of codes. They're either prescriptive, or objective, or performance-based. Canadian codes remain for the longest time prescriptive. They are the most restrictive kind of code you can have. They're straightforward. You don't need engineers to look at them, read them for you. You can just read the code and apply it because they're straightforward. However, they are there are some qualitative provisions in them, and they provide little flexibility. Now, objective-based codes became available in Canada after 2005, National Code introduced them. However, they retained essentially all the prescriptive code requirements in the code. They did not take the prescriptive provisions out, they kept them in there. However, by providing functional statements and objectives, the code became a little bit more flexible. This was an attempt to make them as flexible as possible. Now, the most flexible building code would be the performance-based code. Europeans use them, Eurocode. They set the guidelines, they focus on the overall building and establish a level of safety, and you design to that level of safety. They're not written rules. You can say our Canadian structural code is a prescriptive code. I'm going to blast through these because I think we'll run out of time. So I just want to give you a real life example. This is the landing building in Gaston at the entrance to the Gaston. It was built in 1905. It's 8-story heavy timber construction. It was upgraded in the 1980s. And it primarily contains office with some restaurant, perhaps a small retail unit. This has been there as a landmark. From 1905 until almost 2011, six-story wood frame was not allowed to be built in Canada. And what happened was as soon as in 2009, the provincial government made an amendment to the BC Building Code, then the first project that was a wood frame building residential was built in Richmond, although the Remy project had a construction fire, but it was rebuilt again. Now, another example is the Crest project. This was a mass timber project finished in 2021, and it contained CLT floors and CLT firewalls. When our office worked on the UBC Brock Commons as an 18-story mass timber project, there was no code for that. The provincial government took this out of UBC, and there was a site-specific regulation issued to allow this to happen. Now the building code since then have changed and allows construction of a mass timber building. Now, why codes? Having a code doesn't mean there is no risk. There is always a risk when you enter a building. However, that has to be a calculated risk. And entering a building is just like entering a car. You enter a car, you accept a level of risk. With that said, the changes that I believe are needed is for us to have performance-based codes which allow the most flexibility in design. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now from the con side, Aaron will make his argument. Come on, and let's hear.
Thank you very much. 18%. I'm going to be out of a job by tomorrow. I would like to thank Urbanarium for hosting this event. It's great to see such a full crowd here. I do recognize that the topic is not everyone's favorite. I personally believe strongly in building codes. I geek out on that sort of thing. And as Amy alluded to in her introduction, I have worked with various government entities over the years. And various government entities over the years, including PAVCO for BC Place, YVR Airport, and various other entities. Now, before we dive in, into the Canadian building code context, I do want to kind of go back and look at why and when we got the building codes that we have. So the very first recorded building code, or at least building regulation, was originally from 1792 BC, King Hammurabi. Try saying that a few times, Hammurabi. And basically what it was established on the concept of an eye for an eye. And if a builder constructed a building and it performed terribly and the person inside it died, then they were actually responsible and punishable by death, hence the eye for an eye. Fast forward a few thousand years, and now in Canada, we aren't killing people when buildings fall down. We are a little bit more evolved than that. But we saw a need rising out of the Great Depression for coordinated construction efforts across the country. And as my colleague alluded to, we had the first building code implemented in Canada in 1941. That was a response to the federal government's housing plans to help house people after the Great Depression. And what they noticed during that time is, there is a patchwork of legislation across the country. You had various cities and municipalities who would develop their own criteria with no technical basis, and oftentimes for political reasons to protect their own interests. If we look here on the screen, the example on the far right couldn't actually be built in Toronto because it didn't have brick. So what ended up happening is NRC was tasked, the National Research Council of Canada was tasked with creating a code that could be used across Canada. And I think they've done a fairly good job. We are now into the 16th edition of the building code. And what I really want to point out and hammer home is it's not just a bunch of bureaucrats sitting behind a desk saying, how can I make the architects' lives harder? It's a very balanced approach, and it encourages participation from the public, product manufacturers and suppliers, government entities, and other interested parties. And what I do really want to kind of hit home is they actually do look at cost-benefit analysis, the national committees do recognize that affordability is a concern, and you don't want to implement all these code changes and cause death by a thousand cuts. So as my colleagues would like to say, the industry should go it on their own and we should relax our building code regulations. I'm here to say that we shouldn't do that. We did try that once. It didn't really go too well. So I'm sure we all remember in the 80s and the 90s when we had the leaky condo crisis. We had the culmination of new technologies that weren't thoroughly understood, as well as design choices that were not suitable for this climate, as well as a lack of training and knowledge. But also importantly, we had a lack of accountability. Developers could walk away and wipe their hands clean of it, leaving it onto the homeowner. Codes were changed after that. We now have the Homeowners Protection Office to protect the public. We have increased training for industry professionals, as well as more accountability for architects and engineers. And the reason for this is we don't want another $3 to $5 billion to the economy that could go elsewhere, such as for more social concerns, hospitals, things like that. So how to cope with density? So the single stair exit proposal has come up quite a bit in conversation today. I'm actually going to use an example that my colleague here at the table actually designed. I did not know this going into this. I was a little bit terrified when I found out. So this building's in Chinatown. I don't know how many of you know it. But basically, this building has two exit stairs, if you can believe it. It uses what's called a scissor stair. And if you go south of the border to, say, Bellingham or Seattle, you can't use a scissor stair, which is essentially two stairs in one. You have to build two remotely located stairs. Canada lets you build a scissor stair. In fact, most Vancouver buildings have a scissor stair. You get two exits out of that. People are trying to say, why can't we do one exit? Well, my counter argument is, why? You're sacrificing, what, 3 square meters of floor area, and yet you're decreasing the level of safety by 50%? It's a trade-off. And so as we can see here on these slides, these are what proponents of the single stair like to argue. You can see a nice, beautiful stair on the one side, and you can see the scissor stair, which gives you your two exits on the other. Again, it's about 3-4 square meters worth of difference. The other means of evacuation that haven't been considered thoroughly in the proposal, in my opinion, are fire escapes, which I know in New York they're falling down, but that's more of an old age thing than current technology thing. But most importantly, what are we going to do with the less able-bodied people? What are we going to do with Canada's aging population? Evacuation elevators, is that something we need to regulate? Something we need to look into. And ultimately, at the end, I think it boils down to the three C's: competency, collaboration, and creativity. What I've noticed working in the industry anecdotally is that competency is changing. We are lacking in generational knowledge being passed down through our new architects, building officials, and everyone, which we can accomplish through regulation or increased training, as well as discussions with your authority at the early stage to get stakeholder involvement, and still maintaining creativity. It's always welcomed. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And just coincidentally, the architect of that building gets to speak next. So, Inga, take it away.
Thank you so much. And here you go. And maybe just one word to the building, because I live in the building and I wonder every time I walk by the stair, how is this two staircase making it safer? Because yes, we have an alternative solution because the doors are only 3 meters apart and it's on a hallway with I don't know how many layers of drywall and safety protection. And I go, how could there be that there's a fire right between these two doors in a space which is so protected that it would make me safer? But anyway, I'm asking this myself a lot of time. So anyway, I should talk about I had no idea, and I I actually had the building in the presentation, and last minute I took it out. That would be very funny. So, but before I start, I would like to say one more thing. I'm practicing also in Germany, and I have 20 years of practice in building missing middle, and they all have one stair. And so this is why this topic is very dear to my heart. And I go like, I have not had one situation where it was not safe in Germany. But, okay, let's go to slides. Okay, so first, I would like to start by adding to what we already heard. I was really taken by 1,000 pages we added to the building code. And a lot of these pages are not addressing new realities, because new realities really between where the building code starts was reacting to a great fire, because our building codes are always reactive to a situation. We have new construction methods, we do compartmentation, interior finishes have changed, our evacuation methods have changed, behavior, we train people more how you get out, and we have firefighting, way more technologies, and way more new inventions to be safe. I think it's also interesting when you see the curve that it was starting in the 90s when we were really ambitious and added pages like there's no tomorrow. So now I want to go, really, what is the great fire of today? And maybe we shouldn't wait till we had the great fire, but maybe address it before. And I guess you can all read, this is climate change. And so before I continue, I would like to just show you another graph from Konrad Speck, who is also really with us on the single stair. And look on the right side. Canada is only topped by Uganda, where you need a second stair after one floor. And then this graph goes actually very high, and Switzerland is somewhere at 20 stories. So I don't want to even go there. So that's a big question. But let's just stay on the first six floor and have a look. United States, it's a three-story, but we already know that I think there are five states which have adopted already, or City of Seattle is mentioned here, it's six-story. So it's rapidly changing. Look at all these other countries which allow more. So are they all unsafe? Do we hear more fires in these countries? And the reason why I for the one stair, not because I want to save the space, I'm going to get to this in a minute. But on the left side, I want to quickly address that we have put a building code change in for six stories and for three story, which would be the part nine. Okay, so my big issue is missing middle housing is illegal by code right now, especially if you want to really do something which goes past the two stories. So what is the issue? Our codes are prescriptive that it should be possible to exit in two directions from each unit. And since it's unlikely that you have to be cut off of one of them. So what does that bring us to? It brings us to the long corridors. We all know them from hotels, and this is where they should be and where they're fine. It's a hotel typology, but it's totally not conducive to any active family life. So what I'm proposing, what I'm saying is we need to change, we need to reduce the building code to enable single stair and a few other rules to allow an active social space and neighborhood interaction in the building and for better health and well-being and cross-ventilation in the building. So this was the part nine building, but the same happens when we look at part three, when we look at part nine. And I want to show you an example which I was working on and realized that we have a long way to go to actually build the missing middle. And the same thing, if we would like to have a density and have active social spaces and neighborhood interaction, for health and well-being, we need to change. And from what I learned on this project, what I would like to share with you is that we could not have the windows of the buildings across each other. And so we had to artificially change this development from a part 9 building to a part 3. And we did this by building this tiny little roof over the entrance gate to connect the two buildings. And this way, it is not, it's a part 9 building, and the part 9 building code allows me to have the window openings as we have them. So that's all fine. I changed to a higher building code, but then what comes out of it is a lot of cost, a lot of technology. Basically, it's treated exactly like you treat a tower. So how can that be affordable? How can that be sustainable? And no way to go for if we really believe in the missing middle as a solution. I think I have one more. So my call is we have to reduce the code. Reducing the code is not about reducing safety, but about allowing performance-based codes that address pressing societal and climate needs. Thank you.
Okay, Rick, it's your chance to convince this crowd to move away from 82.
Good evening. I'm here to argue against reducing building regulations for the sake of reducing regulations. Building regulations are never perfect. There will always be current code provisions which will warrant a code change, whether to clarify the language, repeal a requirement, or to fill a gap. Are the building regulations too safe? No, in general, they are not, but they are in constant change of evolution. Code change proposals come from the public. First, they must identify the problem. Is it a gap that hasn't been addressed before? Is it language that must be modified for better clarity? Then they must propose a solution that will relieve the problem. Most code changes take years to work on and finalize for the next edition of the National Building and Fire Codes. Here are some examples where the current code is imperfect and needs improvement. Host stations are for building occupants who have been trained. As a regulation, though, they are excessive and too safe and thus should be repealed. Hoses are expensive to maintain, yet no one will use them. Not the firefighters who can't be assured the hoses have been maintained properly, nor should the untrained occupant use them because they could be dangerous. If anyone wants to know how they could be dangerous, please ask me afterwards. Sprinkler design for garages is not safe enough. Recently, it was discovered the amount of water needed to control a garage fire must be increased by at least 33%, because cars of today contain much more plastics than before. Our regulations are too slow and have yet to adopt the newest sprinkler design standard published in 2022. They still do not address new hazards of mechanical car stackers or an electric and hybrid vehicles. Crossover floor regulations require clarity. The code requires that a person shall be able to travel up or down not more than 2 stories to reach a crossover floor. For a good majority of people, they read the regulations as requiring unlocked doors every 3rd floor. In BC, however, an appeal board decision ruled that unlocked doors are only required every 5th floor. This is an example where most people believe a crossover floor provided only every 5th floor is unsafe, while others believe every 3rd floor is too safe. Again, these examples illustrate that the building regulations are never perfect and changes are constantly required to improve them. In 2005, the National Building Code of Canada was revamped to become an objective-based code. 5 core objectives were identified as being important to Canadian society: life safety, health, accessibility, and fire and structural protection of buildings. Environmental protection was the last one, added in 2015. Every code requirement at the time was scrutinized to determine if it achieves at least one of the objectives. If not, it was deemed excessive or too safe and was removed. After years of sounding the alarm, firefighters were able to bring to the attention of government that the code's inclusion of firefighters as just another group of building occupants was not doing justice to the health and safety of firefighters. Here's an excerpt from the Prime Minister's mandate letter. "You will work to amend the National Building Code of Canada to specify firefighter and first responder safety as a core objective." Indeed, firefighter safety was finally recognized just 3 years ago, and only now is it being developed as the sixth core objective for building regulations. It has been acknowledged the built environment has changed dramatically over the years. Traditional solid wood joists have been replaced with wood I-joists, which has very thin structural members. Firefighters have too frequently fallen through I-joist floors while conducting firefighting and rescue operations. Toxic fumes and smoke from burning plastics somehow make their way into the bodies of firefighters despite their PPE. Lithium ion batteries are everywhere now. They can catch fire spontaneously and create intense flames, emitting toxic gases. Building and fire codes around the world are currently playing catch up to find solutions to this new hazard. Another reason why firefighter safety needs consideration: things do not always go as planned, and it's the firefighter on the scene who must deal with it. The regulations assume everyone will be able to exit the building without delay using the stairs or elevators. Fires will be contained within the fire rated compartments. Sprinklers will suppress and control the fire every time. But we all know fire doors and the self-closing devices wear out. Elevators break down and sometimes takes months to fix. In an emergency evacuation, there may be an elderly with mobility issues who might slow the pace of exiting down the stairs. Yes, sprinklers are great at putting out a fire with just one or two heads. However, after every successful activation, the sprinkler system must be shut down for repairs. Unfortunately, that was the case in 2022 at the Winters Hotel fire, where two persons were trapped and killed. After successfully extinguishing a fire on a Friday night, the sprinklers were shut down for repairs. They were still shut down when the second and fatal fire occurred the following Monday morning. It's nearly impossible to ensure all systems work and all escape routes are cleared on a continuous basis. The local fire inspector will enforce compliance through its inspections and education, but sometimes they must resort to prosecution, which takes time. Meanwhile, for days, weeks, or months on end, the occupants of the building are exposed to a lower level of safety than was designed. So, is there too much red tape? No, not in the building regulations, just likely more red tape in the zoning regulations, and they have nothing to do with safety. Are we too safe? Have we gone too far with building regulations? No, the regulations aim to achieve certain objectives recognized as important for Canadian society. The code is constantly changing in response to problems identified by industry. Any code change proposed will be studied to determine the objectives, including the new firefighter safety objective, are still being achieved. Thank you.
Thank you for those presentations. They did a good job of bringing up some real issues that are not just quibbling over commas or the number of pages in a building code. So we now have 20 minutes where you can ask questions, the debaters can ask questions of each other, and I can ask questions. So if you are interested, maybe you could start identifying yourselves. There are two people, I think, around with microphones. So if you want to start lining up or whatever you want to do. In the meantime, I'm going to ask one question. I've heard a lot about concern about the building code changing to require more for adaptability. to make more suites or all suites adaptable. I'm sorry, I don't know all the details. I'm sure you do. A lot of concern that that is going to reduce building space, make things more expensive, and generally not actually help people that much with accessibility. So I'd like to hear from one person on each team about those proposed changes for adaptable suites. And you have microphones there, so you can just stay there. Yeah.
Hello. So the newly released BC Building Code 2004 has provisions that adaptable dwelling units will be 100% all units in the building to be. Currently, the code has postponed applicability of that until the March 10th, 2025. Reviewing the new requirements shows definitely much larger bathrooms be needed, which could be 60 or 70 square foot larger than the standard bathroom. The bedrooms are getting larger. The clear space required by the bedroom door has to be much larger to accommodate a bed. And the new code currently indicates bedrooms have to be designed to allow a double bed to be in there in order to meet requirements for adaptability. So definitely there are provisions that are kind of onerous in terms of size requirements.
What's your opinion?
In my opinion, I think it is excessive. I just looked around the audience today, and is there a wheelchair accessible person in this room? Hands up, please. I don't see 100%. So in my opinion, it is dependent on the society needs. There are some good ideas to provide provisions so that the units can become adaptable. But once you put a very large bathroom in a dwelling unit, it's not usable as much. So I think I daily I get calls from the developers that are planning high rises and towers for the next 5 or 6 years, and they're very concerned about this specific aspect for sure.
Okay, other side.
So my personal opinion, maybe I'm a bit jaded. I am gonna somewhat agree with my colleague here. Is yes, it does seem excessive at face value. However, why is the province mandating 100%? I think that's a critical question we need to be looking at, and no one in this room has actually answered. The province is targeting 100% adaptable dwelling units because they do not want to discriminate against certain individuals on the basis that having an adaptable dwelling will cause a cost premium for that unit. They're trying to advocate for the public. Now, is the building code the best avenue to go about that? I can't say. But it's all about aging in place, which I think everyone can agree. They don't want to have to move from one place to another just so that they can live. I think everyone has the right to be able to live in their own safe space, their homes, and continue to live in them moving forward. A lot of the changes do seem like they're increasing the size of units, and therefore there's less units per building and affordability. But what I'd also like to point out is these are the minimum prescriptive requirements. You don't necessarily have to do it that way. There are so many other options out there. There's automatic door openers. There's new technologies you can get at things like Home Depot. As long as you collaborate early with your city, your fire officials, and other stakeholders, there are solutions that can be had. It's not all doom and gloom. You have to follow the building code and do this. There are other avenues. And like I said, I don't know if maybe mandating 100% through the province is the best solution, but I think it is a measured response, and I think it is thoughtful.
I didn't realize that was the argument for the 100% requirement. You're all very quiet. There's a question in the middle of the audience there. I think could we get it on the mic? Just this is being recorded, so, and I'm going to ask you if you have questions, a question for one of the other audience members. And also, we're asking that you only ask one person as opposed to the entire panel for your question. Or you could have one from each side.
Okay. Kind of in regards to the last question that we had, where do you see the role of innovation with building construction with the idea of adaptable units? Because you were talking about sizing being too, I guess, too big, like everything's big size, like the sizes of the rooms are too big than necessary. And you were saying that it was good for aging in place and both are valid. Where does the idea of modular construction or different type of construction technology come in place with building code being too restrictive and then having to do, what are the words called? A little special case for one project, and that takes too much time, so then it doesn't become cost efficient for a lot of projects from a designer perspective or an exploration or a pilot project perspective.
Okay, did you get that? What is the role of innovation in trying to solve that issue? Maybe we could start with your side first this time.
It's a good question. We often struggle with that in industry ourselves. What sort of innovation can we achieve and how quickly can we get it in there? So I am going to go on just a little bit of a side note to say that the building codes, the five-year cycle can be a bit slow, but the problem that they've actually identified at the national level isn't so much that it takes 5 years to update the building code, it's that the provinces are lagging. Manitoba, I believe, was one example. It took them another 3 or 4 years to adopt the code. So you're looking at 9 years of waiting for building regulations to change, and that's just not fast enough. So the goal now at the federal level is to provide harmonization so that all of the provinces can adopt code simultaneously without modifying them to suit their own needs. Because again, as I pointed out in my presentation, you can see competing interests which may have no technical background. So the national committees are very, very aware of that, and they are trying to mitigate or minimize that. They are also studying different products out there. Any product supplier can come forward and say, hey, you know, I have a new grab bar type of backing or a wheelchair lift. Is this something we can put into the code? They will put it to the committee. They will do a cost-benefit analysis, so it's not like, hey, we're going to add $10,000 to every unit. They will measure the pros and cons. So I think the process is pretty good, but I will concede it could be faster to respond to changing times. Hope that answers your question.
This time?
Sure. I'm probably taking a bit more of the designer approach here. And you asked about prefab and about changing. I think there's lots of opportunity to actually come up with new solutions. And I'm super interested in bathrooms. My students know that. Because again, like I find in North America, we have the same bathroom everywhere. There's no variation. If you travel around the world, there's lots of different options. And you could have to shower towards your now bigger bedroom, and all of a sudden you borrow space from one to the other. So, but that means we have to also rethink how we design it and not just saying we need this room, this size, this room. There has to be overlays and new innovation on how we do this.
Great, thank you. There was a question in the third row here.
Hi, so I'm a student from the UBC's Master of Urban Design program. My name is Elise. I have a question that is particularly, I guess, for Erin, but also for Professor Inge, where I question whether livability and affordability here with building code has a contradiction in between the two. So as we try to enhance the livability of residential units, are we also making them less affordable because now the sizes are much bigger?
He said it was a very good question.
Thank you. Without taking too much time, my particular area of research interest concerns this very issue where while we're trying to achieve better affordability through various ways, I feel as a practitioner as well in design that building code somehow is making it very formulaic and perhaps difficult to do.
Okay, so basically is livability, by which I mean, I understand you to mean you stay alive in it. There's an overprescription of that, and it's affecting affordability. That's the question.
Couple days to think about that one. Read a response. Oh, it's so broad. It's hard to say definitively. I think I am sounding a bit like a squeaky wheel. The codes do take that into consideration. I know anecdotally we've had some developers around town here offering $10,000 bathtubs as part of their units, and then that's driving up the market. Now you're seeing units across the city increasing. So I would say that's more of a market-driven force than necessarily a building code prescriptive requirement driving the affordability. We are trying to address the affordability through building codes, but we also recognize it shouldn't necessarily be a trade-off. We don't want to be stacking people into, say, you know, pod hotels and saying, here's your unit. That being said, we do want to be cognizant to get people off the street because housing is a human right, and we need to kind of be cognizant of that. So the committees are working on it, but as Rick also alluded to, they're not perfect. And I would actually encourage anyone in the audience here to either reach out to the City of Vancouver. They have their own building code. You can write to your councillors. They can put it in to say, hey, you know, we'd like to see the code change. You can do the same thing at the provincial level, and you can also reach out to NRC at the national level, to the code board, and recommend changes that way. So, hope I answered your question.
And your side.
Okay. Again, I'm probably more the designer approach here. I don't think livability and affordability are so opposites. I think we have to really focus on what is important for the livability. And I think in a reductionist approach to really think about what do we not need, not how we need more, and really focus on the quality, the spaces we need. And I think this could really also help with the affordability. I think it's more important to have a smaller space and have cross ventilation and have basic needs than having a bigger space. And I have no natural light, and I'm stuck in a big space which is not livable. So I think we have to rethink what livability means and what we really need to make it livable.
Thank you.
Can I make a quick comment?
Yeah.
So the building code under the appendix notes does discuss, it's almost like a cost-benefit analysis. You know, you can throw in as much as safety features, as much as accessibility, but does it get to a point that it becomes almost unaffordable? Like when you look at it, single bathroom being enlarged by about 50 to 60 square foot at a $1,500 for new builds right now in Vancouver, that is almost $100,000. So you essentially, the entry level buyers will no longer be able to afford those units. So in my opinion, that this one aspect by itself is kind of the cost becomes so high that it becomes almost unaffordable to have a, you know, bachelor suite per se.
Okay, thank you. Oh, there's a question up in the next to last row there.
This is probably for Rick Chung. We've been developing a lot of alternative solutions as part of the new code. And what I've noticed is that the prescriptive code is considered a baseline zero. And I would argue that it's actually a solution. Not necessarily a minimum solution, but is a solution. And what we find is every time we go for an alternative solution, we're always being asked for another pound of flesh, even though the performance doesn't actually get affected. And so it's permeating from municipality to municipality. Every time We try to do something that's slightly variant from the code, even if it's not really a big code issue. It's an interpretation question, and that's where I think most of the problems I'm finding are. It's not the code, it's the interpretation of the people that police it for us.
Yeah, that was addressed to Rick. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the question. I agree with you at some point. So yeah, alternative solution is to have an alternative to an acceptable solution, so you're correct. So what's in the code as acceptable solution is just one way to achieve the objective. But you also look at the functional statement that what you're trying to replace it with, what is that doing, and what the alternative solution is trying to provide the same level of performance based on that function. So not just the objective, but the function.
What we're finding is that you just keep the code consultants that we honor just keep throwing stuff at the wall till we get enough pieces in there that everybody's comfortable. And many times when I look at it, it's clearly not improving the safety of the building over one that was built. Often sloping sites is one where you get all of a sudden it becomes a seven-story building because there's a mezzanine way in the back of the parkade, two stories underground. It's actually a safer building in many ways, but because it's concrete and all it's suddenly a six-story or seven-story building, it just drives me crazy. You can tell it's not a safety issue. It's really just a question of interpretation of the code and a lack of flexibility on the people that administer the code. That's certainly my opinion.
Sometimes though, we are bound by the letter of the code, and it's written. Interpretation, you have to interpret what's in the code. Maybe intent, maybe you may be trying to get to the same intent with a different solution. But I guess the rules of the game here is that, yes, we have to play by the rules, and it's spelled out quite, in some cases, clearly, in other cases, not. And you're right, there are a lot of things that are subject to interpretation, which I showed you with the crossover floors, right? That's always subject to interpretation.
I've literally had a townhouse project where they decided to, because it was a sloping site, decided to call the parkade an extra story. So we had to adjust the grade up 3 inches in order to, suddenly it met the code. And how we pile 3 more inches up of dirt around the edge of the parkade and makes it safer is completely beyond my comprehension. But that's the kind of stuff that we are dealing with. And it not only takes a minor amendment to a development permit, it delayed the permit by 3 months, and all of that stuff for 3 inches of dirt. And that's where the problems are. That's where the real problems are. It's the interpretation, it's the lack of flexibility, it's the intention that we have to be 100%, when the truth is 95% is plenty safe enough. And that's where I'm having the problem. And I understand, because it's being administered by people, that there's no benefit for them to say yes. There's clearly a safety thing in saying no. And really, that's where I think the biggest problems I'm finding are.
So your question leads me to the last question that I'm going to ask. We've got 52 seconds left, actually. It's kind of related to that. But you argued at the beginning that we should move to a performance-based code. I've heard from the other side that what a prescriptive code does is then you don't have to hire your own engineer. You just follow what the rules are, and that actually a prescriptive code makes it more expensive because you have to hire your own experts to prove that you're meeting the performance standard. So if one person from each side could explain what they think is the benefit or not of moving to a more performance code.
So in my opinion, performance-based codes establish a level of safety, and then you design to that level of safety, as opposed to objective-based codes currently say, this is prescriptive code, we have this objective, try to meet that objective. So the objective-based codes stop creativity. They're not as flexible as performance-based codes. Performance-based codes, you can come up with multiple solutions for one challenge, whereas in prescriptive codes, you kind of you get narrowed down into one path.
And the counter?
Okay, so my take on this is, I think it's a bit of both sides. Performance-based codes do have value. Whether we should be implementing them or not is hard to say. I mean, what I'm hearing from the audience is people aren't enforcing prescriptive codes. How are we going to enforce a performance-based code when everything's a little bit more abstract? Prescriptive codes, they're like a menu. You get more options. And part 9, which is for smaller houses and things like that, was originally implemented for people who did not have engineering backgrounds, that you could just go and build a house, you just follow these step-by-step instructions, you'll get your permit. So there's a few ways we can go about this. We can add more prescriptive requirements, and then yes, to Francis's point, we do not need to necessarily hire engineers and other professionals. Not that I want to put myself out of a job here, but I will say, you know, in the grand scheme of things, the engineering professionals doing these sorts of solutions, it's a drop in the bucket. I mean, for what you get, actually some of our developers will save hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars. Say you don't have to dig down a whole nother story to manipulate your grade calculation. There are certain trade-offs and cost benefits. But what I will say, and again, squeaky wheel, is the competency is changing. Good or bad, I'll leave that to the audience to decide. But as an example, the National Research Council came out in 1995 with what's called the User's Guide, which was basically kind of a how-to use the building codes. 1995, maybe it's time we update that. It is a super great resource. It basically tells you these are the assumptions that went into the code, and that is something I think that is lacking in this day and age. So what we see now is not just building officials, code consultants, or even you know, our designers, they're reading the code and they're trying to make the best of what they can based on black and white text. And while there are intent statements behind that to say, hey, you know, limit the spread of fire to a neighboring property, they don't actually define what you have to do for that. So it becomes very nuanced and objective, and that's where things get bogged down. So is a performance-based code where now that becomes kind of more at the forefront, the right way to go? Hard to say. But I don't necessarily think going one way or the other has a significant impact on the affordability. I think, as I said, there's trade-offs between the two.
Great. Okay, now everyone gets their last say for 2 minutes. So, Cash, you're up first. And should they come up here or just stay there? Yeah.
Okay, 2 minutes. There we go. So, I'm here to advocate for flexibility as a code consultant. The more complex the building code gets, I become busier and busier. So I'm very busy already. Now, what I like to kind of touch on is what Scott over there talked about a few minutes ago. And that's when there is gray areas in the current prescriptive code, even though there are some functional statements and objectives, it's very hard to achieve them. It's you get different municipalities having different interpretations and different requirements for them. So they tell you this is required, and the code is really one solution. The second solution is an alternative solution. And it's very difficult to pass these alternative solutions in some municipalities. So my advocacy is more flexibility. My advocacy is for allowing the designers and engineers and architects be engineers and architects and come up with the best solution they can within a guidelines, and that comes from a performance-based design. And the cost of construction has to be part of the solution. There has to be an intent to make sure adding requirements does not increase the cost of construction to a point that becomes unaffordable.
Thank you. Aaron, you're next.
Okay. I think I agree a lot with what Cash is saying. I think we do definitely in Canada need to be flexible in the application of our building codes. I will concede, you know, the more you regulate, the harder things become. I mean, the states, I think their building code is something like 1,300 pages. Kind of crazy. I actually am scared to kind of open that book every now and then. But flexibility, I think, is key. And not only that, I think we actually need to get more participation, particularly from the public, in our code's development. That was one of the issues that they did identify is, you know, engage the public. We also want more funding, is what NRC was saying. Because they do recognize times are changing, affordability, climate change and accessibility are very, very topical, and they want to be on top of it. They want to work with the public to provide affordable housing, safe housing, and something that benefits all Canadians. And I think that's something everyone in this audience can agree upon. What I do want to read out actually is just kind of one quote that they identified the National Research Council as part of their codes committees back in 2004. They weren't advocating to put more prescriptive regulation in, but they were calling for what's called smart regulation, targeted interventions. And so what they say is, smart regulation is not deregulation. Smart regulation does not diminish protection. It strengthens the system of regulation so that Canadians can continue to enjoy a high quality of life in the 21st century. Regulation should support both social and economic achievement, providing citizens with the protection they need to feel safe, supporting the transition to sustainable development, encouraging a more dynamic economy, and creating opportunities for Canadians and a model of regulatory excellence in the world. I'll leave the last sentence, regulatory excellence, at the audience's kind of discretion to digest. But I will say, the codes can be improved, but we need the flexibility. And I think we can get there. I think a lot of this is problems that can be solved. And as I said before, you're encouraged to reach out, engage with these committees. It's not meant to be kind of that code officials or architects or engineers are the only people who can create change. Anyone can create change. If you have a good reason or a concern, share it. Thank you.
Okay, I think that's the most Canadian speech I've ever heard. I almost started crying.
Sorry.
Okay, Inga, your turn.
Okay, so I'm really advocating for the performance-based codes, and mainly because we have really a lot of pressing societal and climate change needs we have to address, and I find a lot of the codes as they stand are not addressing this, or even worse, are not allowing you to do things which would actually help with creating more climate-friendly buildings. And I just would like to say one more thing, since you brought the building up as your point. I have to say it was actually very difficult, because this is alternative solution, and I agree with what I heard in the audience. Why are we not trusting our code consultants? Any engineer would go, and we trust the engineer. You don't go to City Hall and the engineer is questioned if the structure is right, but the code consultant has to go in, and depending who is at the city, will fight if it's working or not. And I can tell you it wasn't easy to get the alternative solution. So I thought that was really interesting that the pro code is actually bringing an example, which I say was a difficult one, or where I really say performance-based codes would really help. But we have to give also the professionals enough power to actually do the performance and not having it being stuck at the municipality level to make the decision. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Rick, you get to bring it home.
Okay, thank you. Performance-based codes, that can go many ways. And as a regulator, I've experienced as a regulator for many years, we see a variety of quality submissions. So with performance-based codes, how do we regulate? How do we ensure that performance design is actually meeting a minimum level of excellence as we would expect it to, provide for safety, for accessibility, and so forth? So objective-based codes, I think, is the best of both worlds. We have an objective-based code, a performance, an idea of what we're trying to get at, which is the objective. We also have a solution given to you. Instead of having to spend every project, co-consultants to come up with a solution, you have a solution set for you already. Alternate solutions is always available for designers that provides for creativity, and for common solution or common issues we see time and again, you know, our regulators will, for example, in Vancouver, we have the ability, and thank goodness we have the ability, we can recognize that there are common issues which you can deal with, and we will change regulations for that without having to go through alternative solutions and so forth. I would also say, back to the point what Francis made in the beginning, yeah, there's always tension. Always tension between various objectives we want in our buildings. You know, there's always tension between affordability and accessibility. In Canada, nationwide, the national code is full steam ahead, trying to catch up with the nations around the world who have signed on to the United Nations declarations for the rights of persons with disabilities. And it's a catch-up game in the national sense. So I'm living that right now. It takes a long time for issues to get more passed. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. So thank you to the panel. Let's give them a round of applause. I just have to say I really appreciated the thoughtful discussion here tonight, and unlike so many issues that I cover, the remarkable lack of disinformation and misinformation and hysteria was really refreshing. Now I have to go back out into that world, sadly. So I appreciated that. I learned a lot. One final comment I'd make is I feel like there's some research missing sometimes, because I told you I was working on a story about single exit buildings. And so I asked Conrad Spreckert, currently the top Canadian researcher, well, what are the statistics on people dying in single stair buildings versus non-single stair? And he said, I've been doing research for 3 or 4 years. I can't find those statistics. They don't seem to exist. And I also talked to the Fire Chiefs Association in Seattle, where they've allowed single stair in six-story and fewer buildings since 1977. And I also asked, do you have any statistics? And he said, we don't collect them that way. We don't collect by, did this person die in a tower, a single-story house, or a single-exit apartment building? So that seemed like a remarkable gap if you're thinking about changing the code. So maybe that's another issue for another day. So anyway, having said all that, now we get to vote again. I don't get to vote, you all get to vote. So we're going to have this second QR code to follow for you to follow. And once again, just a reminder, the motion is reduce building code regulation. So it can't be on anything else that you heard. It's on the motion. So go ahead and vote. Do, 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 do. Okay. And the winner is Moonlight. No, okay. wrong card. Okay, the second vote is pro 69%, con 31%. Whoa. And this was a tough crowd. This was a tough crowd. I'm actually really surprised, and I'm pleased for you. And it's good to know people can change their minds, because often when I work in journalism, it doesn't seem like that's possible. So so Marta Fairvog is going to present the Smart City Award to the two members of the winning team. And
thank you very much.
And our great pro side gets t-shirts. And all of those are non-flammable. I just want you to know.